Good evening. May I have your attention, please? Welcome to American Islamic College Academic Lecture Forum. We're so happy to have you all here with us today. Just a little housekeeping, we will be live tweeting hashtag AIC lecture. Before we begin, I kindly ask you to turn your cell phones off or to silent so that we don't have any disturbances during the presentation. Thank you. If you enjoyed the music that you heard this evening, it's by artist Sami Yusuf from his new album Baraka. AIC is very excited to announce that he will be performing here at the college February 17th, Friday. More details to come, so mark your calendar, save the date. Sami Yusuf will be here in Chicago at AIC. Inshallah. Well, we are very pleased to have with us this evening our very own President Daoud Stephen Casewit. He will be presenting on landmarks in the history of Medina in the prophetic age. President Casewit is an independent scholar, writer, translator, and lecturer of Arabic and Islamic studies. Mr. Casewit spent most of his previous professional life in the Arab world, including nearly a quarter century in Morocco, where he managed the Moroccan American Fulbright Commission and directed the Arabic Language Institute in Fez. From 1984 to 1988, while serving as a university instructor of English and linguistics in Medina, he developed an intimate acquaintance with the history and geography of the Prophet's city. He has published a number of academic papers and delivered a range of guest lectures on related topics. He prepared the appendix of historical maps for the HarperCollins study, Quran. He holds a master's degree in linguistics from the American University in Cairo. Please give a very warm welcome to President Daoud Casewit.
I'm trying to gauge the audience, because usually when you speak, you want to speak على حسب عقول الناس, and I mean according to the mentality and what the audience understands. But it is, I mean, it looks like predominantly you are people that have a good idea of the outlines of the Sirah Nabawiyyah, of the life of the Prophet, because of course many of the things I'll be talking about deal with that. Sometimes in greater detail than you might want or be interested to know, or you might not have the background to understand the significance of certain things. But I will be very, very open to questions and comments and remarks after the talk. Perhaps it's best, since it's a PowerPoint presentation, for me to move through it, and then at the end we can go. But the only exception, I would say, if there's something on a particular, and there are several maps, on a map that puzzled you, or you had a question about, I don't have a problem with looking at one of the graphics and discussing it. So with that understanding, ala barakatillah, wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. I'd like to begin this talk, which focuses on al-Madinah al-Munawwara, with a hadith that helps us understand the epithet al-Munawwara, the radiant. Why is Medina the radiant? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was known to have recited this prayer: O God, place in my heart, place light in my heart, and light in my sight, and light in my hearing, and light to my right, and light to my left, and light in front of me, and light behind me, and light above me, and light beneath me, and grant me light. And the fact that the Prophet lies buried in Medina's pristine soil is, of course, all the more reason to call Medina al-Munawwara, the source of the light that we enjoy in Islam. It's a very challenging topic to talk about the landmarks, historical landmarks of Medina Munawwara. And the reason for this is the 10 years which the Prophet spent in Medina, approximately 10 years, 13 after the revelation came in Mecca, then the Hijrah, and then 10 years in Medina Munawwara. Those years were so replete with different events. The Islam that came to America, excuse me, that came to Medina, is you can't really recognize it as the same Islam almost that when the Prophet died. Ramadan was instituted. Zakat as a formal element. I mean, several major pillars of Islam were created. Prayer was formalized into the five daily times. But aside from that, all of the political events and historical battles and so forth, which took place from Medina. And sometimes, if you are a student of history and you look at the Medinan period, you could say that, in a sense, what preceded it in Mecca was a little bit like the mission of Christ, of Sayyidina Isa, his whole life, because it was a persecuted religion. It never became embodied in a state or a theocratic entity. Whereas the 10 years that the Prophet spent in Medina, alayhi salatu wasalam, is equivalent to about the next 4 or 5 centuries of Christian history, when Christianity became a state and got armies and laws and expanded and so forth. And so naturally, Medina is going to be home to many, many, at least in principle, many, many historical landmarks. Hence, what I'm presenting to you this evening is merely a selection. And you'll forgive me if there's a favorite thing that I have of yours that I haven't commented on. There are many ways to present this. The images are mostly my own. Quite a few of them dating from the 1980s, the mid-1980s, including this one, when the Prophet's mosque only had 4 large minarets, were actually just these 2, which are modern ones, and these 2 were originally part of the Turkish structure, which in Mamluk structure, which was there. Just for a moment, let's dwell on the word landmark. In Arabic, probably the best word for landmark is ma'lam. And ma'lam is not too far from the function of an American Islamic college in Chicago, because it's related to ilm, it's related to ta'lim, it's related to all these things. And so a ma'lam is a gate to knowledge, a monument to cognition, and a vehicle of remembrance. Just a little bit of a reminder of where Medina lies geographically, strategically. It was a large, well-watered, fertile oasis, settled since distant antiquity. And it was a very important halting station in north-south trade which linked the Indian Ocean and East Africa with the incense-producing regions of Yemen up through to the Mediterranean. Gaza was here, also across to Mesopotamia. There were long-standing ties between Mecca and Medina, because the Quraysh, as is well known, were important, the most important trading community for quite some time. And they utilized Medina as a stop when they were heading up to Palestine, Syria they called it, Sham. And as proof of that, One should remember that the Prophet's great-grandfather, Hashim, he married a woman of Medina called Selma, and she bore him a son who was later known as Abdul Muttalib. Now, he was on his way to Gaza, where he died. He never returned, actually, to Medina. And his family eventually came to Medina to find out what happened to the boy, Shayba, he was known as. And it was Muttalib, another uncle of the Prophet. No, not uncle. Great uncle. Great uncle. Right, great uncle. Also, the Prophet's own father, Abdullah, himself led commercial caravans northward into, at that time it was might have been Persian, even Persian territory, perhaps not, or Byzantine territory. It wavered between the two of them, but into Sham. And on one of the journeys from the north back through Medina, Abdullah fell ill and died in Medina. Most accounts say that he died when the Prophet ﷺ was not yet born. He was. Some say he was born, others say he wasn't. And Abdullah is buried in Medina. His grave used to be known, used to be clearly marked, but now it's incorporated. I mean, the space is incorporated into the greater mosque of Medina. Abyssinia, Al-Habasha, at the time of the Hijrah, there were probably close to 70, 80 Muslims living under the protection of the Negus, of Najashi, in Al-Habasha. And they were actually remained there, and it was Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, who was kind of the leader at that time, Ali's brother, older brother, and they remained in Habasha for about 8 years. I mean, they didn't come to Medina until the year 7, when it was the siege of Khaybar. It was during that period. So it's interesting just to sort of look around you. When the Prophet emigrated from Medina, of course, the Muslims, those who weren't able to flee to Abyssinia, and those who had no powerful protectors, suffered a great deal. There was persecution, there was torture, there was insults. And the Prophet ﷺ was determined to go somewhere, and sought invitations, finally got an invitation from a small group of native Muslim inhabitants from Medina who offered him their protection, solemn protection. And when the Prophet had a vision of where they would emigrate to, the vision said it would be a saline flatland, sabkha, with date palms between two tracts of volcanic rock. These are the tracks of volcanic rock, Harra. They call it now Harra Sharqiyya and Harra Gharbiyya, but there were earlier names, and Wabr. And this is a depiction. It's a map I created after studying the situation in text for many, many years and becoming familiar with Medina. This is the north. This is Jebel Uhud. This is a smaller mountain called Jebel Sila. And the Prophet's mosque is about right there. And that's where Baqi al-Gharqad, the famous cemetery, is. And Quba is here. And this is another mountain called Jebel Ayr. And this is a very famous torrent bed called Wadi al-Aqiq, which plays quite an important role. And this is Wadi al-Butan. The slope of the land goes from north, from south, to north or southeast to northwest. Medina had endured a period of bitter civil strife for about a century between the Aus and the Khazraj before the Prophet's arrival. The most recent battle happening about 5 years before the Hijra, called Harb Bu'ath. It was a battle fought in the lava rock plain there, and so it was desperate for an outside mediator, a unifier. This image shows, on the one hand, you can see part of the eastern lava tract. You can also see the date palms, which are such an essential feature of Medina. You can see that what houses used to be made of, rock, particularly basalt rock, and mud was the mortar. And this is Jebel Uhud. And behind it is a mosque that no longer exists, of Ali al-Uraidi. But Medina became Dar al-Hijra, the abode of emigration, the abode of flight, the refuge in a sense. But it remained that in a certain metaphorical sense for all of us, because with the conquest of Mecca in the year 8 of the Hijra, the door of technical Hijra was closed. You could no longer say, "I'm emigrating to Medina." They didn't need any more people, and it wasn't justified because you could be a Muslim almost anywhere in the Arabian Peninsula. But as a metaphor, as a place that had been established by the Prophet, where you could go as a Muslim and declare your allegiance, your affinity, you could learn Islam. Medina will never cease to be Dar al-Hijra. That's the eastern lava tract. Could we turn off one of these lights? One of these? Yeah. That's the eastern lava tract. How would you like to ride a camel across that? You know what a camel's feet are like?
I would like to walk.
Even walking, right. I mean, or a horse. Try to gallop a horse into attacking Medina. I mean, it would be quite difficult. And if you're an attacking army, that terrain doesn't work at all. What terrain would work? Right here. You come up from Mecca and you attack from the north. Because everywhere around it, it's like three sides of a fortress, a natural fortress. You could attack by single file secretly, and you'd have to have very good guides, but you couldn't do it in a mass. You couldn't do it with horses. You couldn't do it with camels. You'd have to come from that direction. Remember that. So there's a natural defensive barrier on three sides from a mounted attack from the outside. Oh, excuse me. There was something on this I had to point out to you. In Medina, when you do make ziyarah, when you visit the Prophet's city for your own spiritual benefit and to greet the Prophet, there are four principal places of visitation. And the most important of these is, of course, the Prophet's mosque. That's where you go to pray. Today it's commonly referred to as al-Masjid al-Nabawi, sometimes it's just, or al-Haram al-Nabawi, or simply al-Haram. But you will find out why that is actually not very accurate to call the Prophet's Mosque the Haram, because the Haram actually applies to a much greater area of Medina. I mean, it was a declared a protected sanctuary. The next one in order of importance, I believe you could. I mean, it's a kind of a toss-up between Masjid Quba. And going to Masjid Quba, in many, many hadith, it's said that if you go there solely with the intention of praying two cycles of prayer, rak'atayn, in that mosque, you have the merit of an umrah. What a blessing, especially to the Ansar of the Prophet's time, when you couldn't even go to Mecca. I mean, it was unthinkable. So you, in Medina itself, you had the possibility of earning that kind of reward. Baqi al-Gharqad Cemetery, there are probably about 10,000 companions buried there. That's what they estimate. There are about 10,000 companions, many, some very, very famous ones, including Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu an, and many, many others. And the reason why it's a primary place of visitation, I know some Muslims are kind of allergic to the idea of going to cemeteries and so forth, but that's a little bit of a new, more modern phenomenon. The Prophet ﷺ would regularly visit the Baqi al-Gharqad in the evening, and he taught Sayyidah Aisha a prayer. What do you say to the people of al-Baqiyah, the people who were buried in al-Baqiyah? And there were very, very special prayers for mercy upon them and forgiveness and so forth. And equally so for the cemetery of the martyrs at Uhud, the great battle, which we will talk about later. That is a primary place of visitation, based on the Prophet's own practice of going there frequently. I mean, when I say frequently, I mean at least on an annual basis after the battle. He would go and he would visit the grave of his uncle, Sayyidina Hamza, and the others, and ask for blessings upon them, and would say that they respond to your salam, to your greetings. And if you're attentive, it's something that you might notice there. In Medina itself, there were many, many other sacred sites and many, many other mosques. We tend to have the idea that, in Medina there was the Prophet's mosque, and some of us may know about Quba, and some of us may know about Qiblatain, which is about right there, which we will talk about. But in fact, every clan of the Aus and the Ansar had its own clan mosque. There were probably about 30 separate mosques across Medina. It's a huge oasis. I mean, this is about 15 miles from here to here. And there were settlements and little villages and hamlets in many, many different places. And so mostly people prayed, except for the Salat al-Jumu'ah, they prayed in their clan mosque. And it wasn't uncommon for the Prophet ﷺ to go to their clan mosques and pray with them. And so these mosques in which the Prophet prayed gained a special status. If you read the histories of Medina, you read, and so-and-so said that the Prophet prayed in this mosque. And so-and-so said, so these mosques, at the time that the Umayyad Caliph al-Walid, and this was in about the year, between the years 88 and 91 Hijri and 707 to 710 Miladi, or the common era, the Caliph Walid ordered that the Prophet's mosque be demolished and rebuilt, and in fairly quite elegant style. I mean, in fact, it disturbed a lot of the companions and sons of companions, who thought it was just ostentatious and too much. But the governor over Medina was a very famous individual, and I'm sure most of you heard of him, Omar ibn Abdul Aziz, who, radiallahu anhu, who later on became caliph himself and was noted for his piety and his, you know, the God-fearing way in which he went about his business. So he was governor of Medina, and he was tasked by the caliph of rebuilding the Prophet's mosque. Stone and teak roofs, and I mean, mosaic work on the walls done by Byzantine craftsmen. I mean, it's amazing when you read about it. But in addition to that, he went around and asked people Where did the Prophet pray? Where did he put his head down? And when I say masjid or mosque, I'm not talking about a monumental building. It could just be an enclosure with goats on that side and drying dates in that corner, and this is the place that the clan had set aside to pray, and that's where the Prophet prayed. So there were no buildings necessarily. There might have been walls or maybe a little bit of shade. And Omar ibn Abd al-Aziz, at about 40 different sites throughout Medina, built commemorative mosques at the places where the Prophet prayed. And it's thanks to that, you know, it was how many centuries ago? I mean, it was 12 and a half centuries ago that he did that. And it was thanks to him that a lot of these mosques survived. Many, many didn't. I mean, in urban development and revolutions and, you know, Medina changing hands and so forth. But it's thanks to him, Omar ibn Abd al-Aziz, lay sabahu al-khair, that many of the mosques or the mosque sites survived. And this is an example. This dates from the time of Omar ibn Abd al-Aziz. It was not roofed. It was simply walled in with basalt stone, and there's a mihrab to indicate the direction of prayer. This is west of Quba Mosque. It has a number of different names, Masjid Musabbih. But very small. And it's simply a place so that people who are visiting Medina, it's a ma'alam. They say it's a place that enables them to know, to recognize what happened and where. This map, which you've seen several times now, that's the direction that the Prophet ﷺ came from Mecca, because Mecca is to the south. This is the north, and he was traveling not in a big caravan that had to. Big caravans would follow the course of the riverbed and come from the north, and it's right here that you have Thaniyat al-Wada. Thaniyat al-Wada. There's no Thaniyat al-Wada down here. And so the song, the beautiful song, and it's still very beautiful. And this isn't meant to sort of, you know, rain on your parade about the Talal Badru Alayna and so forth. But Thaniyat al-Wada isn't really a part of the Hijrah. Thaniyat al-Wada was very much a part of the Prophet ﷺ coming back from the campaign Tabuk al-Kubra of going to the north, and they came back that way. But in any case, came to Quba, and Quba was in the southern part of Medina, and most of the Muhajirin were already there. I mean, they had proceeded by 2 months, 3 months. I mean, they'd been there for quite a long time, and that's where the Prophet initially settled. He settled, or not really settled, but he resided. And here you have a picture of almost the route that he might have taken. And in fact, this new highway, it was new in 1980, was called Tariq al-Hijra, the Hijra road, or the Hijra highway. And this is from one of the four minarets, here's one, of Masjid Quba. This is the courtyard covered with that covering, and the date palms around it. And that was the way to Mecca, right there. The Prophet ﷺ arrived in September of 622, and it was the time of date harvest. So there was actually a fair amount of food at that time. I mean, that's when dates begin to be harvested and begin to become ripe. Masjid Quba is mentioned in the Quran, and most people interpret this verse in the Quran, concerning a mosque founded on piety from the first day. They say that refers to the people of Quba. There are some differences of opinion about that, but it was that verse when 20 years later, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, when he was caliph, and he was trying to define to to devise a dating system for the Islamic Empire, because there were different dates and letters would go out and they couldn't really understand, would this response come before that one and so forth. And so they said, if we want to have an Islamic dating system, what should be the starting date? Should it be the year of the Prophet's death, even, I mean, or should it be his birth? Should it be this? And in the end, they said, no, it should be the Hijra. Because the Hijra was, in a sense, the great watershed moment of Islam. When Islam, from a persecuted minority, became the religion, public religion of a state. And so that's what they decided. And so that's why you call it the Hijri calendar. And they were guided to that choice partly by the verse in the Quran, a mosque founded on piety from the first day. The idea of time and first day, and well, let's make that our first day. From Quba, and he might have stayed there only a few days, he might have stayed there a couple weeks, there are a lot of different reports about that, it doesn't really matter. Obviously he had to be very careful about where he was going to reside in Medina. And even leaving the place where he was in Quba, it was a bit isolated, and it was surrounded by certain Jewish tribes, and it wasn't the ideal center location from which to really carry out his mission. And so, if you remember the story, his camel, Qaswa, was left free to roam without him controlling the reins. So he couldn't say, you know, I'm going to go here. He said, don't grab her reins. She's going to take me, and God is going to decide. And with that stratagem, of course, he eventually made it to the center of Medina, that beautiful manor. But on the way, he prayed the first Friday prayer in Islam. And you think about it, in Mecca, they'd never prayed the Friday prayer because it was too dangerous trying to get together. I mean, they really rarely prayed together, perhaps in houses and so forth, but they never had a public Jumu'ah. And in Medina, they had the first public Jumu'ah, which means suddenly Islam is in a free environment. Suddenly it can establish its own rules. And if you recall the tale of Qaswa, she stopped near the, I mean, actually it was right down in there. And she, you know, sat down, and then she got up and walked a little bit, and then sat down again, and that was it. And the closest person or house was that of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. And he had the good sense to immediately undo the Prophet's saddlebags from the camel and carry them into his house. And when everybody started grabbing the Prophet and so forth, he'd already had the saddlebags in his house. And then he says, a man has to go with his saddlebags, you know. And so he went to Abu Ayyub's house. And he lived there for a period of about 7 months, during which the Prophet's mosque was constructed. Very, very simple, with a tiny residential compound. At that time he had one wife, and then he married another wife at that time, Aisha. And so he didn't need that much space. Gradually it grew, the residential compound. The mosque served many, many different functions. I mean, we think of, actually, mosques in Chicago serve many functions too. I mean, you can play basketball, and you can go to a library, and you can, I mean, it's pretty amazing, some of the mosques in the Chicago area. But none of your mosques compare with this, because this was not only the prophet's residence, but it was a community center, that I guess you can compare with that. Town hall, that's where the people met to discuss important matters and be informed of things. Courthouse. Debating hall, that's where he had many of his great debates with other delegations, delegations of Jews and Christians and so forth. I mean, there were theological debates. Hospice. Guests would be put up in the courtyard. It was mostly a courtyard. There was a very, very small area that was roofed over very lightly, but most of it was an open courtyard. Hospital. After battles, the Battle of Uhud, they brought all the wounded to that hospital and treated them there. After the Battle of the Ditch or the Trench, that's where Sa'd ibn Mu'adh died. I mean, of his wounds, radiallahu anhu. The Prophet at that time had an aspiration that the Jews of Medina, who were very powerful and quite wealthy, would at least acknowledge the validity of his mission. Maybe not for them. They would, you know, you are the Prophet of the Arabs and so forth. And at this time, the Muslims and Jews shared a common qibla, prayer direction. Muslims were praying in the direction of Jerusalem, and the Jews were also in their temples had the same direction. They observed a common fast. This is before Ramadan was revealed. You had Ashura, and you also certain other dietary restrictions were common to both groups. This very, very busy map. You're looking at different elements of the population, and so among the three most important tribal divisions, with the exception of the Jewish, I mean, actually, you have the Ansar, which are divided into Aus and Khazraj, and so here you have Aus, but Khazraj, it was extremely complicated. It wasn't simply the Aus on one side and the Khazraj. Every clan had its, and sometimes they aligned with different forces. The three main Jewish tribes, you had the Banu Qaynuqa, which were in this area, not too far from the mosque. Then you had the Banu Al-Nadir, and then you had the Banu Qurayza. And the Muhajirun, most of them lived in the vicinity of the mosque, but not all of them. I mean, some of them also married Ansari women and sometimes lived with them in the outlying areas. Actually, it's important to point out here that the Jewish tribes had been living with the Ansar for centuries in Medina. There was intermarriage. There were men whose fathers were Arab chieftains and whose mothers were of a Jewish tribe. There were close, very close alliances. For example, the Aus had a fairly close alliance with the Banu Qurayza, and the Khazraj tended to be more close, but it shifted. It often went one direction or another. And so it was an extremely complicated situation. And at the beginning, the Muslims were by no means a majority in Medina. They were a minority. So you had all of these forces to contend with. So it's not like the Prophet ﷺ marched into Medina and was crowned and he became king and controlled everything. He didn't really govern at the beginning. He was one leader among others. And if you read the so-called Constitution of Medina, you will see that. I mean, you will see that there were a lot of powers and factors. About 17 months after the Hijrah, after praying 17 months towards Jerusalem, after trying to accommodate the Jewish rabbis and discuss things with them and face their animosity and so forth, there was suddenly an assertion of the distinctiveness of Islam and an emphasis on the ancestral faith of Abraham. And this was embodied in the change of Qibla. And the Qibla changed 180 degrees from the north to Jerusalem to the south, approximately, in Mecca. And this mosque, Masjid al-Qiblatain, the mosque of the two Qiblas, or the two prayer orientations, all mosques in Medina, all historical mosques, are Masjid al-Qiblatain. I mean, the Prophet's mosque was also Qiblatain. It had two Qiblas. It had one to Jerusalem and one to Medina. So it's not unique in being Masjid al-Qiblatain. But what makes it unique, there's a story behind it. That the Prophet ﷺ went to that tribal area of Banu Salama, and he was visiting them. And he was invited to a meal and so forth. And after the meal, they got up to pray. And in the middle of the prayer, Salat al-Dhuhr, the midday prayer, which is four prayer cycles, he prayed the first two, and then the order came from God to change the Qibla. And so he turned around and faced Mecca. And the men all revolved around him, and the women revolved around them, and they all turned. It was like unquestionable obedience. If the Prophet's doing this, all right. I mean, we're with him. So it's like a marvelous monument to that concept of unquestioning obedience. I mean, here the Prophet is doing this, and without asking, they accepted it. And this is where Islam really takes on its self-identity, its affirmation. And it was followed shortly thereafter, of course, by preparations for the Battle of Badr. And on the way to Badr, or actually, there it was common that if you were gathering an army together, you would do so outside the city. And that's what this was at one time, called Suqya. It's now where the train station is, the terminus of the Hejaz railway. And you would gather your troops and your supplies and review the troops and say you're too young and go back and so forth at a kind of camp. And you might be there for a day or two. And this particular camp at Suqya had a well. The well is long since disappeared. And it was when the Prophet was reviewing his ragtag army, which, you know, maybe less than 400 men, maybe 300 and what is the number, 60? 13? Thank you. 313 men. He asked for water from the well, and he prayed at this spot. And later on, a mosque was built there in the time of Omar ibn Abdulaziz. And this is the prayer that he uttered. And listen to what he says. Allahumma, verily Ibrahim was your bosom friend and your servant and your prophet. And he prayed for the people of Mecca. And I am Muhammad, your servant and your prophet and your envoy. And I pray for the people of Medina, for the like of which Ibrahim prayed for the people of Mecca. We pray that you bless them in their measures of sustenance, sa'ihim wa muddihim, and in their fruit-bearing crops. In many cases, there are other versions of this. They say, and bless Medina with twice the blessing that you blessed Mecca. I mean, there are many, many hadith along those lines. Allahumma, make Medina beloved unto us. Because they were muhajirun. They were homesick for Mecca, and they loved Mecca. So it's saying, make Medina beloved unto us. And by God, that prayer has been answered. I mean, by Muslims around the world, I mean, Medina is beloved. Make Medina beloved unto us, as you made Mecca beloved unto us. Finally, this very important point that helps you understand why you can't call the Prophet's mosque Al-Haram al-Nabawi. I declare that which is between its two lava tracts, to be an inviolable sanctuary, haram, as you made al-haram of Mecca inviolable by the voice of Ibrahim. And of course, in Mecca, you call it al-haram al-Ibrahimi. In Medina, it's al-haram al-Nabawi. And what is the haram al-Nabawi? It's a very, very large area. It's not the mosque. It's in a much larger area. Has many rules, no hunting, can't do this, can't do that. But one thing which made it a little bit difficult to keep up with where its borders and so forth, it has no ritual significance, the haram of Medina. Whereas in Mecca, once you cross that line, and the border has been of the haram in Mecca has been kept. It's a huge consecrated space. And so, in this particular hadith, it says, "And I declare that which lies between its two and between." It doesn't necessarily mean in this narrow space, but it could be from its borders. All of this, or in that general area. And other hadith talking about the extent of the inviolable sanctuary of Medina say it's between Eir and Thawr. And the exact location of Jabal Thawr has been a subject of debate for a millennium. But I believe it's a small mountain here, and so if this is the haram, you can see the extent of it. I mean, you've got nearly 20 miles here, and then maybe 12 miles across. So that's the haram. That's the haram.
Thawr or Salah?
This is Salah. Yeah, this is Salah. And Thawr, people said Thawr is in Mecca. Yeah. But there are many Thawrs. And this was one. If you look in the hadith, Thawr is in the hadith. And Eir or A'ir is there are many versions. Those two mountains are mentioned, and a lot of medieval geographers couldn't locate where is Thawr, and they're asking the Bedouin and trying to hunt for it and so forth. But I've read a lot of studies about it, and I rather think it includes Uhud. And one of the reasons why it should include Uhud is, quite apart from the battle, Uhud is a solitary massif. And if you know Arabic, you know that Uhud is related to Ahad. It's related to oneness and unicity. And it's a single massif, huge granite composite mountain. And of it, very famous, and I'm sure most of you know this, the Prophet said, Uhud is a mountain that loves us, and we love it. It loves us, and we love it. And other hadith, some of which are in slightly weaker collections. I mean, about Uhud loving us is in every possible collection. They say, and Uhud is at one of the doors of paradise, or it stands at the ala tura, I mean tura al jannah, however you want to translate tura. I mean, there are some words that are really hard. Could be terrace, it could be channel, it could be. I mean, there are many different things. But in other words, that it has this celestial nature. So Medina is a mountain that you can see from almost everywhere in Medina. Wherever you are, Uhud is there, kind of looking down upon Medina. That's Uhud. The Prophet's mosque is somewhere here in the center, and this is Wadi al-Aqiq. And the reason I wanted to show you this is to talk about the Prophet's sensitivity to celestial grace, or manifestations of celestial grace, of barakah. And there are many, many hadith which not only talk about Uhud as being an embodiment or a symbol of paradise, but also wells. This wadi is called al-wadi al-mubarak, because the Prophet received an order from an angel saying, pray in this wadi al-mubarak on one of his campaigns. He was camped in the soft sands there. There are wells which are described as bir min abyar al-jannah. I mean, Medina is full of these things, but of course the most famous is probably the one that, I mean, all of us would love to pray in all the time, and you know, if you go on during Hajj, even in Ramadan, you can barely get in it, and it's Rawda. Rawda min Riyad al-Jannah. It's that part of the mosque which lies between the minbar, the pulpit, and his residences, or his residence. Sometimes they say it's his grave, but I don't think that's the original hadith. Rawda min Riyad, a garden of the gardens of paradise. And that's on this earth. And so the Prophet's sensitivity to that, he lived with one foot already in Al-Akhirah. I mean, he could sense things that other people couldn't sense. This is looking towards Quba Mosque. This is Jebel Ayr, which in some accounts is the opposite of Uhud, because they say, and Jebel Uhud, Jebelun min Jibal al Jannah, and this is Jebelun min Jibal al Jahannam. And there are various stories behind it. I mean, I think with good reason, you know, Bukhari and Muslim struck those passages and just left, this is a mountain that loves us and we love it. But it is still part of the sacred geography of Medina, that it has this was facing Mecca. I mean, in the early days, I mean, and that's where all the danger came from and so forth. God knows. Any case, that's not the reason why I'm looking at this. These dates, are there any, these date palms, are there any, is there anything about dates that is related to paradise? La'ajwa. La'ajwa min fakihat al-jannah. I mean, is of the fruit of paradise. The Prophet said that. And you can still get ajwa. They're not very small, dark little dates, you know, but they have a unique, almost licorice-like taste. The soil in Al-Aliyah, the heights of Medina, the highlands of Medina, is also well known for its medicinal qualities. Badr, Prophet and his companions overcome a much greater army at Badr, which is about 2.5-3 days camel march away from Medina. And they come back victorious. I mean, it's miraculous. But the Quraysh don't waste too much time. That was in the year 2. And by the year 3, in about a year, they had assembled the wealth and an army and weapons and allies and so forth to attack Medina itself. So with 3,000 troops, allies, the Quraysh came. And I mean, if you think back about Medina and where you could attack with an army with horses, it's from the north, of course. And so they camped there. And the Prophet, when he, in his mosque, which is a town hall and a gathering place and so forth, that's where they gather to discuss what should they do with this army approaching and coming upon them. And those young, eager, hot-headed young people who hadn't been able to earn glory and divine reward at Battle of Badr were so keen to go out and meet the enemy that they marched out. They decided to march out, and the Prophet Islam, that wasn't his opinion, but he left it as a matter of consensus and consultation. So there's Uhud, and there's very northwest corner of the Prophet's mosque. So he marched, not exactly along this line, but approximately, probably went through Thaniyat al-Wada'a here, and then made his way this way, and in the very early morning, spent the night at a place here, which is also built into a mosque, Masjid al-Dira, and then this wadi, of course, I'm showing it with water in it, but at that time it didn't have water in it. Most of these wadis are torrent beds that fill a couple times a year and sometimes really bad floods, but normally don't flow with water. But here I'm just showing it where it ran. And this little protuberance there. That's Jebel Rumah, the Mount of the Archers, the Archer's Mount, or Jebel Ainain, where the Prophet positioned his 50 archers. So he came, he lost part of his army when he was here. He had 1,000 men and it was reduced to about 700. He was fighting against 3,000. And he positioned archers here and his main army there with their back to the mountain. Quraysh had their camp here. They were getting ready to attack Medina through this route. And by positioning the archers here with various obstacles in the way, and the wadi generally, if you've seen a wadi in a desert, it cuts deep into the ground, and it would be probably, you'd only have a few access points to cross it. And one of them must have come very close to the mountain so that you could control. Khalid ibn al-Walid was no beginner in battle, but he couldn't get past the archers. And so the archers are positioned here, the two forces meet, and initially the Muslims overcome the Quraysh and their enemy and begin pushing them backwards. Khalid ibn Walid with his horse, and Muslims didn't really have horses in this particular battle, couldn't take advantage of the situation because he couldn't go through his own lines of infantrymen. You're gonna be doing more damage to your own side, and he couldn't get to the side of them or the back of them because of this. And I believe there were also walls around archers here, so that it made it very difficult for him. But the archers had been given strict instructions: stay on that mountain, regardless of what happens. If we're all cut down, stay there. If we are victorious and so forth, stay there. But the archers, they saw the Muslims rushing into the enemy camp and helping themselves to all sorts of things. They said, whoa, we're kind of missing out here. We've won. And despite the fact that their commander said, no, don't go and stay, and the Prophet told us to stay and so forth, most of them abandoned their posts. And it was at that point that Khalid ibn Walid was able to overcome them. And then he rode into the flank of the Muslim infantry and began causing chaos. And fairly soon thereafter, it took some time, of course, but what seemed victory turned into bitter defeat. And the Prophet and his companions, a band of them surrounded the Prophet and escorted him into this gorge here. Some of them went up the slopes of the mountain, because if you're on a slope and a horse is trying to attack you, you have every advantage. I mean, you can just reach down and pick up a rock, and horses hate rocks. I mean, and they hate arrows too. And you have the advantage of the high ground. Many of the Muslims fled back to Medina and fled in different directions. And for the 70 Quraysh that were killed at the Battle of Badr, there were 70 Muslims that were killed at Uhud, and they are buried there. This is from Jebel Uhud, from not quite the top, but close to the top. And this is the battlefield. That's actually the Mount of Archers. Central Medina is here. This is Jebel Sila. Here's the gorge into which the Prophet and his companions fled and then went up the hillsides. That was in the year 3. In the year 5, the Quraysh again assembled a great army, partly with aid from the Beni Nadir, who had been exiled and were in Khaybar and planning things with the Banu Ghatafan, and they decided that they would finally do away with Islam. And it was one of the largest forces that Arabia had ever seen, 10,000 men. The Prophet had perhaps 3,000, perhaps, under his control. And they had not too much more than a week's advance notice that the Quraysh were about to march on them. This depiction is like a fairy tale. It's a bit of a fantasy. It's a little bit, it's a, not entirely, it's sort of like a stylized version of what Medina was like in late Ottoman times, with a walled city around it and so forth. But at the time of the Prophet, nothing could have been further from the truth. It wasn't a giant fortress. It was scattered hamlets, scattered defense towers. And so they couldn't rely on this kind of fortification. But what they could rely on was the lava fields surrounding Medina from three sides, which is a natural defense barrier against horses, against mounted troops. And within Medina, this is an example, these are the date palm gardens. And every garden, whether it has 50 trees or 600 trees or 12 trees, is surrounded by an enormous wall made of basalt stone, which is actually dug out of the earth that you're farming in. And so these high basalt walls, very narrow, it's a maze. All of Medina is surrounded by these things. And any invading army, unless you have an incredible guide who really knows it, is going to get waylaid. You don't have any advantage in force in going through a city and you know what's happening here. And if you're a native, you know exactly where to spring upon the enemy. So this was a natural defense. This is where Salman al-Farisi urged them to build the trench. And that's all you needed. Can you see the logic of that? You have about a week to dig this trench. So this is the soft underbelly of Medina. This is the vantage point from which it can be attacked from the north. This is lava tract. And if you do this, you're closing off the mouth, that mouth. But what was the trench? The trench was about a meter and a half up to 2 meters wide, meter and a half perhaps in depth. And you'd think, what good is that? And it might not be very much good, but they were very clever, of course. All the stone and rock that they cleared out of the trench was put on the defender's side. So in addition to a trench that any horse would have to hop over, they would have to hop over a very large mound. And horses can't really do a distance and a height together. Not most horses, any case. And then if you were the defender, and rocks were very, very important weapons at those times, you had all the rocks right in front of you. The ammunition was all right there. Of course, you used bows and arrows for longer distances and so forth. But it was ammunition and defense. The Muslims stick with that one. The siege lasted about 25 days. And it was a pretty cold period, a period of great stress, of great difficulty. And at every point, the enemy was trying to challenge the trench. They knew they couldn't do it here very well. And at the same time, they were also tempting the Jewish tribe of Beni Qurayza to renounce their pact of mutual defense with the Prophet and to kind of join them, to stab him in the back. And in the Quran, when they talk about this battle, they talk about enemies Dunakum and Fokakum. And Fokakum, this is in the heights of Medina. And Dunakum is there. This is Jebel Sila. It has two pronunciations. And that's what it looks like from the west. It was a perfect citadel to watch the movements of the enemy and be able to shout, they're coming, you know, to this place or to that place. And it's still a marvelous, interesting place with Turkish, little Turkish forts on it. I mean, I used to go up there with my family. This is what it looked like in 1985. Doesn't look like that anymore. This is the so-called Sabah Masajid, the seven mosques. Now it's kind of, there's one large mosque, but I believe Masjid al-Fath, this particular mosque, still is there. And they've preserved it. This is, again, another one of the mosques that Omar ibn Abdul Aziz had built, a commemorative mosque called Masjid al-Fath. Has several other meanings, but why is it called al-Fath? That it's a spur of Jebel Sela. It's kind of a bulging protuberance of the same mountain. And it was there that the Prophet, he prayed for victory for three successive days, on the Monday, on a Tuesday, on the Wednesday, and on the Wednesday between Dhuhr and Asr, he had a positive response and he knew that victory was his. And to this day, it's recommended that if you have a really urgent request, that you go to this mosque on Wednesday and pray between Dhuhr and Asr. I've tried it works. Between Dhuhr and Asr, I mean, if it's a valid request, and to pray there, Masjid al-Fath, al-Fath. Finally, I'd just like to conclude with a few remarks. We started out with looking at ma'lam and what is a ma'lam, what is a landmark. And from a spiritual or religious point of view, religious history especially, the function, one of the functions of landmarks is to reinforce spiritual imagination. I mean, that you go to a place and, this is where this happened and this happened and this happened. Sadly, much of the ziyarah in Medina, I mean, is taken up with shopping and other things. And there are fewer and fewer people that really know the deep stories behind things. I mean, one of the more remarkable places in Medina, Wadi Butan, which was described as Wadi min Awdiyat al-Jannah, it was paved over and Dairy Queen was put on top of it. I mean, those things happen, and as perhaps in this age, the celestial things are meant to be hidden. You know, I mean, I'm not fighting against it, but it's valuable to be able to reimagine and, in a sense, relive your religion and be reminded of who was here and who did that, and so forth. And finally, this is in the Baqiya, in the famous cemetery where 10,000 companions are buried, that is east of the Prophet's mosque. You see the green dome there. And these people who are visiting the Baqiya, I didn't blame them for this. They weren't looking at bodies. They were just contemplating death. I mean, which is a good thing. I mean, dhakirat al-maut. They're looking into what does a grave look like inside. You know, I mean, what they were just. I mean, and from all different races and so forth. And here's this hole, and you're going to be put in a similar hole one day. What's it like? You know, I mean. But if you think. The Prophet, there are a number of hadith which speak about the Prophet's bodies not being consumed by the earth, and prophets being alive in their graves and praying. And there are several hadith which speak about the Prophet having his spirit returned to him when one of his followers greets him, so that he can in turn respond to the greeting and reply in kind. And so a landmark isn't just a dead monument. It's a source of barakah. For the vast majority of Muslims who have not been blessed with being among the Prophet's companions, there's this consolation. Among those of my community with the greatest love for me are a people who come after me. This is a hadith. each one of which will wish that he could see me in exchange for his family and wealth. It's related by Muslim and Ibn Hibban. And the ziyarah, the visitation to Medina, is a means of demonstrating this love. Commenting on the famous hadith about faith recoiling to Medina like a snake into its hole, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani remarks, "Every believer has a driving force of his own soul impelling him to Medina due to his love for the Prophet. May God bless him and whelm him in peace." Now this embraces all epochs. He goes on to explain that the generations of Muslims after the prophetic age are drawn by this love, desiring to visit his grave, pray in his mosque, and to imbibe barakah through witnessing his historical traces and those of his companions. Thank you very much.
Presentation. We are limited on time. I know there are several questions, so please just raise your hand and I'll try to call on you.
Dr. Wasil, that was before me.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm just a humble student of human life and Muslim. And I just want to say one thing, that the Muslim community of Chicago has been greatly blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Dr. Daoud has come here to be one of us, because communities are enriched because of the even the knowledgeable people who join them. And I never heard such a great presentation on Rasulullah's life. The South Asians are somehow we grow up in an environment that as soon as somebody mentions Rasulullah, we start crying. Something that I noticed among Pakistanis and Indian Muslims. You had mentioned Abu Yuvan Sayyidullah, in whose I was in Istanbul, and I had the privilege to pray one tajud at his mazar. And please say something about, because it must be a long life that Allah Ta'ala gave him. And the Turks actually, the whole mountain had become Kabristan because they wanted to be buried closer to
absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. I actually spent in the summer of 2010. I spent 2 or 3 months there. I was working on a manuscript, and I was in Ayub Sultan in a house that belonged to the Nadir of the mosque, the supervisor or whatever superintendent of the mosque and mausoleum of Ayub Sultan, and I found it fascinating that Ayub Sultan, he wasn't actually a warrior with the warriors. He was a kind of carrier of barakah and a cheerleader, and you know, he was quite feeble and old when in Umayyad times they brought him to the walls of Medina. And when he realized that he was dying, and it wasn't from wounds, he was an elderly man and maybe he was sick, he said, "Bring me as close as you can to the walls and bury me there." And so they did that, and with great reverence buried him and so forth. And when the Umayyad commander realized that the siege was not going to succeed, Constantinople at that time was an impregnable city. I mean, very, very difficult. You needed al-Fatih to really accomplish that. He negotiated a retreat. I mean, in those times, things were done by negotiation, and even a retreat was done by negotiation. And so, I don't know if he met the emperor or with whom this dialogue occurred, but I was told that the Byzantines said, what were you doing? I mean, burying that reverend companion of yours. I mean, do you realize when you withdraw, we're gonna lay waste to that grave? And the commander says, if you touch a single blade of grass on that, good luck to all of your monasteries and churches, and because they control most of them in the Middle East. And so the Umayyads, trimmed the grass and pulled the weeds and so forth. I mean, I think they were very, very considerate of that particular plot of land. Anyway, please.
Was that commander?
I've forgotten now.
Yazid ibn Ma'awiyah.
Exactly, right. It was Yazid, ironically. Yes, yes, subhanAllah. Yes, now I remember. Yeah. Please.
Great presentation. I echo what Dr. Vasila said. It's a blessing to have someone like you in the Chicago Muslim community.
Thank you.
You alluded again and again to the spiritual aspects of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life. And many of the actions and deeds, such as the hijrah. And it wasn't just any immigration. I mean, a lot of us were not born here, we immigrated too.
True.
But that hijrah was something very unique. You called it watershed, and absolutely what it was. Because it was a break away from everything else. Just like you said, when they prayed the first Jummah, it was an assertion, okay, we are here and we are independent and free. Hijrah was part of that process to me. Could you speak to that, please, the profoundness of that hijrah, that migration?
Yes. Of course, the root of the word hijrah, it's used in various senses in the Quran, and among them is to shun, to cut relations with. And there was an aspect of the hijrah which was really you begin to realize what a sacrifice it was for the Meccans who did it. It was turning your back on everything that kind of made you a person in Arabia, your tribe, your family wealth, your means of livelihood, all of these things. I mean, you were shunning it, and that shunning couldn't be reversed. It was a sworn oath of hijrah. And you were only allowed, if you went on Hajj or something, to stay 3 days in Mecca. You couldn't stay longer. I mean, there was something. I mean, that was perhaps also one reason why the hijrah was abolished as a possibility after the conquest of Mecca, that they didn't want more people that couldn't go back to their homelands and so forth. But it was also a rebirth, in a sense. I mean, you died to a certain part of you and a certain aspect of you, and you were reborn in a community that was defined less by tribal affiliation than by your affinity to the values of the Quran and the Sunnah. I mean, it was a religious affiliation. Tribes still played a very important role. I mean, you couldn't disregard that. But there's a report by Ibn Abdullah Ibn Omar, who was critical of someone who kept saying Quraysh, Quraysh. He said Quraysh, Quraysh. He said we used to say Muhajirun, and we would be proud of it. I mean this kind of emphasis on it, and the Ansar. To call them the Ansar, the Aus and the Khazraj were bitter enemies for decades and decades. There was so much blood spilled between them. And so when you call that, but also one of the first commands that the Prophet gave, alayhi salatu wasalam, when he reached Medina, not single command, but sort of recommendations, was ifshu salam wa أُطْعِمُ الطَّعَامِ وَسِلُّ الْأَرْحَامِ وَصَلُّ بِالْلَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسِ نِيَامِ وَتَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ بِالسَّلَامِ. Spread peace through saying Salaamu Alaikum. And for them, for the Arabs of old, language wasn't just something you bandied about. I mean, if you said something, you could kill somebody with a word. I mean, you could shame them for the rest of their lives. I mean, words were so important. It was an oral culture. And if you said salam in a community like Medina that had been riven with civil strife and so forth and had so many different factions, salam alaikum, and you started hearing that, it must have affected the mentality. And it became Dar as Salam. That's also one of the names of Medina besides Dar al Hijra. Yes.
So what I understood, you know, so this represents the migration and the Medina itself is the rebirthing of a identity, human identity, based on the convictions. Should I say that? Is there any hadith or any narrative from the time, at the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him, or is there companion? Anybody has envisioned that, you know, at that time, the people would be coming, other than just the Haram, Masjid an-Nabawi, or the Roza to Rasul, that the people, the generations coming after, would be tracing the same, you know, recharging their real identity based on their conviction, you know. I lived there in Saudi Arabia in 72 for 3.5 years, so spent much of time in Medina. But maybe I was too young at that time too. But, you know, I missed that. All those roofs and different monuments and historical sites, you know, I believe any believer would like to recharge their own identity, you know, through those sites and stuff, you know.
Indeed.
Is there any kind of a reporting or narrative, the saint of the Prophet or the companions, you know, in terms of preservation of these monuments, you know, because I don't see, you know, they are preserved. Or if they are not preserved, or maybe easily identifiable for people who are not from that part of the world.
Right, and many are just destroyed.
It's like unfortunate, you know. We know the basic sites, you know, Rawa Hira, and you know, those sites.
There's
Mala,
yes. It's a very good question, and has many different levels that you could answer it. There is a structure, rather large, important stone structures in Medina that Medina was famous for, called Utum or Atam. And these were defensive towers. They could be square, some of them were round, some of them were two-story, three-story. And generally it was for a clan, like their stronghouse. I mean, like you would retire the women and children there in times of war. You might endure a siege there. And when the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina, there were probably about 110 of these. Some hamlets had three or four, some had one, and they were scattered all over the city. And there is a report where the Prophet ﷺ once said, don't destroy the Atam of Medina, for they are its ornamentation, something like that. I mean, that they're beautiful. I mean, that he liked them, and he remembered certain ones from the time that he spent there with his mother when he was a small boy. She died, of course, on the way back to Mecca. But I think, to some degree, we're not necessarily sensitive fully to the fact that the Prophet ﷺ had a certain aversion to building. I mean, once he came back from, I think it was, I don't remember which campaign, it might have been Tabuk, and one of his wives had built a stone wall to sort of help shield her house. And he was like, that's the worst thing that a Muslim can spend money on is building. And his own mosque was built of the simplest materials. The columns were date palm trunks. And the bricks, it was all mud, adobe brick. It was unfired adobe brick. And the roof was, I mean, there were crossbeams, of course, also of quartered date palms, but it was date palm branches, and then the leaves kind of woven together and covered with mud, so that when it rained, you'd be prostrating, you'd come up, and you'd kind of have mud on your forehead. And that was the Prophet's style. And when people came to him and said, look at the Byzantines, and they, you know, they have big, you know, stone cathedrals, and why are we... He had such a feeling of the imminence of the Yawm al-Qiyamah that he said, I would like it to be like the hut of Moses. I mean, keep it as simple as possible. And the two caliphs that followed him, Abu Bakr, radiallahu anh, when he became caliph, he simply replaced some of the date palm trunks that were beginning to decay, but made no changes. Omar did the same thing, kept the same material. He said, don't you introduce any colors and black and red and green and blue and then ornamentation. He wanted it as simple as possible, but he extended the mosque by one row in the direction of the Qibla, and then Uthman did it two rows. And so I don't know if for him the idea of preserving a particular monument, although when you think about the Quran, and very often the Quran talks about the signs of God on the horizons, and among these are also the signs of how God punished previous peoples, and you can see the ruins of those peoples. I mean, you have them at Al-Hajar, the Nabatean, they would have been... Hijr. What do they call it? There's another...
That's in North America.
No, I know. Just trying to think of the name that they call it now, and I can't, it just escapes me. I mean, it's like you have Petra, of course, but down much further south, even south of Khaybar, you had some remarkable ruins, and they're mentioned in the Quran. Like, look at them, Madain Saleh, Jazakallah Khairan. It just didn't come to me, and the Quran asks, have they not opened their eyes and seen when they travel? I mean, what happens to people who were much more powerful than they were, and how they were abandoned and punished because of their disobedience and their rebellion and so forth. And it points that out in many stories of prophets. Some places we know where they are, some places we don't. Your question's a good one, and I think
to follow up on that, yeah. You know, when I read Quran and it says As-Safa wal-Marwa, means Shu'ayrillah.
No.
Safa and Marwa is just meant Shu'ayrillah, because when I look at the Safa and Marwa, Quran says that this is the Shu'ayrillah. Means, the way I perceive, you know, and I might be wrong, you know, when I look at that, that gives me a more strengthen my conviction to my faith. The same way, you know, when I go to Medina, you know, I wish all those sites, you know, where I met, whatever I get into my knowledge, that gives me a strength of in my conviction to my faith, connecting me with the glory of the past, you know, not in terms of a material glory, but the glory of the faith or the spirituality or the truthfulness, you know, or the truth.
Yes.
So I was wondering, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described, what is the Shu'ayrillah? What I understood, the Shu'ayrillah means anything that connects me with my faith, that is the Shu'ayrillah, you know.
Right.
Allah is the Shu'ayrillah.
Right.
So it's not mentioned in Quran.
Sha'airillah, or Masha'ir. I mean,
monuments.
It has that meaning, it has a lot of meanings.
But he's saying, Safa and Marwa, these are natural
But it's in the same. I mean, they're physical embodiments of another order.
Monument in terms of the physical sense, but it's a historical context. When you go and look at, you know, it gives you freshen up your thoughts, and you know, energy bring you as some sort of energy, you know, in your faith, connect you with that history, you know, because I remember, you know, the last khutbah of the Prophet, peace be upon him, you know. And it's a one paragraph where it says that the old people who listen from my mouth convey to the others, and the others convey to the other. Hmm. And the people who will come in the land, they may understand better than, maybe they will understand better than you who are listening from my mouth.
Hmm.
So, I mean, this is a very, you know, deep thought, you know, of the Prophet, his vision. That that's what really describes about the glory of the Quran. But the Prophet, peace be upon him, says that the wealth of the Quran will never end. You know, I mean,
Just we have time for one more question. I'm sorry.
I'll stay here till midnight. I mean, whoever wants to talk. I mean, but go ahead.
The estimation of the width of the trench of the Khandaq. I think 1.5 meters too
narrow or too wide?
Too narrow. I think the minimum estimation was 5.5 meters.
What 5.5? They weren't defending against infantry. They were defending against horses. And on one side you had a big mound. And so when they first started attacking, and suddenly there was this trench. The men that the Prophet had at his disposal would have never been able to. 5.5 meters is like, you know, from that wall to no way. No way.
It's 300,000 meters of debris. So that's
where'd you get that? when they describe the trench, it's in terms of zirah. Yeah, I mean, and there are various ways to measure that. There isn't one standard on this, but it's about a half a meter.
The least estimation was 9 cubes.
You're talking about the length?
No, the width.
9 kilos?
No, cubes, 9
cubits.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are lots of reports. I mean, and I remember being in Medina once in a council of scholars, and one of them standing up and saying kama ittafaqu alayhi jami'ul ulama, as all scholars have agreed upon. And a Syrian gentleman kind of put his hands up, it was a Saudi talking, he put his hand up, he said lam yattafiqu jami'ul ulama ala mas'alatin qit, you know, have never agreed on a single issue ever, you know, if it's an issue, I mean, on the basic principles. And so this is an example of that. It's very difficult to do history from the Quran, almost impossible. And the hadith is also very difficult because usually there isn't
accuracy.
Historical context, and there are differing ones. I mean, and differing people saw different things at different times and so forth. Yes.
I want to comment on the, you read wide range of Sirah and history, there is discrepancy of numbers and figures and distances.
And dates.
That's no way you could find, know how much, you know.
I'm not arguing.
It's an interesting point.
No, I'm just wondering. Meters is too narrow. That's what made me think about it.
I mean, if it's a horse that has to clear, you know, the width of that table plus a mound that's quite high, that's enough. If I mean, and you're talking about a horse with a man with armor and weapon. I mean, it's a heavy lad and a horse. You can't jump far. I mean, it's worth discussing all those things. I'm willing to answer, talk about other things. I mean, if you like.
Only one tried and they shot him. That's only one. Tried to jump and they shot him.
That's right. Or he fell down the trench and Sayyidina Ali went down and dispatched him.
Don't take those figures.
It's interesting.
Well, thank you very much.